Good morning, and welcome to worship at Northwood United Church. We gather together here in Surrey, British Columbia, and on behalf of the congregation of Northwood, I welcome you to this gathering in faith. We gather on the unceded lands, the Kwantlen, the Catesy, and the Semiamu peoples, and we are honored and delighted that we can gather here and worship together. And we're glad and delighted that you are a part of that as well. For that is the nature of God. God's welcome, God's grace is extended unto you, welcoming the lost, welcoming the hungry, gathering us together that we might receive light and hope and guidance for the journey. And so come and worship the God who is there for each and every one of us. Come and worship God through Christ. As we gather, we celebrate some of the symbols of our faith, touchstones that continue to guide us throughout life's journey. A cross is a reminder that death is not the end, but indeed God is doing a new thing. Indeed, after death, God brings out new life. We celebrate a God who brings transformation, hope, and guides us into the tomorrows that we are indeed given. Our Bible, a compass, a guide for our life as we navigate life's ups and downs, that we celebrate with God in our life and even through the challenges that God guides us through. We read scripture and we encourage us to find a way to plumb the depths of these ancient texts, finding how they might inform us in a modern day setting. And finally, the Christ light. Jesus once said that I am the light of the world. And whenever we gather around the Christ light, we're reminded indeed that God's way is light. Light into our darkness, hope into our despair. So let us gather around the Christ light today in worship. Separations. Divisions, we live our lives filled with them. All of those boundaries and separations, those barriers that we see in our world and in our society, and sometimes that we're not always aware. We want to have a conversation about those. Because today we meet a curious text about two different worlds, the Canaanite world, the Hebrew world in which Jesus was a part of. Those two worlds clashed, hated one another. And in this story, we learn God's way of surprising compassion. Perhaps in this world of separations and divisions, this message might have some information for us today. And so let us guide. Be guided by these words. Let us find hope in our journey. Come, let us worship God. Well, friends, before we move too far ahead into our gathering and worship, just a few announcements to guide us forward into our time together and into the coming weeks ahead. First of all, it's nice to be back. I have really been missing the church, and it's so good to be back, and I can just kind of feel your presence here as we gather for online worship. I've had some study and some holiday time away. I won't do a full show and tell of my time away, but one thing that you'll just wanted to share that will come up in this service is I took a preaching course, and as you know, we all just want to kind of get better at what we do. So I took 2 weeks of courses, and the one course that I'm wanting to speak about just briefly is a preaching course that I took with the Reverend Dr. Melissa Skelton. She was the first Archbishop here in Vancouver, a female, it was just an honor to work with her, a very established preacher, and just had some great insights for the craft that we work on. And one of the things that we got to do was we preached every single day by using the same text and just kind of getting deeper and deeper into that text. So the text that I'm using in today's service is from that course, the text that I was assigned. So you'll hear lots more about that, and hopefully it was a week well spent. I sure enjoyed meeting some new classmates and just an enjoy a week learning. So thank you for having me back, and I appreciate just the great work and ministry that Reverend Dorothy and Reverend Gabrielle offered. I really enjoyed their services as well. If you're joining us by the Zoom worship gathering, we're just so pleased that people do take an opportunity to connect. The links come out on the Friday email, and it's an opportunity just to join us live at 10:30 and really feel a little bit of connection, offer some prayers together, see one another as we gather together in song and in worship. And I invite you to just take an opportunity for that if you haven't done so already. After virtual coffee, worship is virtual coffee, and we gather, fill our mugs with our favorite beverage, and just gather for some fellowship after worship. So that happens about 11:15, 11:30. Same Zoom link. You're welcome to just hop on and join us for some fellowship, get to know you time as well. I always enjoy seeing folks at that time as well. As you know, the thrift store is open, so spread the word, drop in. We got some great things happening at the thrift store Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday. Lots of things are happening in our online ministries, even through the summer months, as I've been noting. We have Tuesday Spa. There are some Tuesday nights that we've been gathering for the discussion group, and a reminder of Sunny's yoga channel that you can keep your practices up until things start up again, hopefully. Not to promise anything yet, but hopefully in the fall. Our virtual coffee time gathers at 10 o'clock on Wednesday morning by Zoom. And the virtual book club is meeting their next one. They're reading ahead for their August book, August the 11th. So just next week, Ordinary Grace by William Kent Kruger. Those are the announcements that I have for our community. And as always, I welcome your creative sparks, your ideas for ministry, and how you might like to move us ahead and get involved yourself. Just let me know. As we now move into our gathering in worship, we take a moment to put aside all the busy, distracting parts of our life, important things indeed, but the things that might just for this time take us away from God. We turn off our telephones or just put aside those things that can wait for just the next little while and become more fully present with God. And so let's take an opportunity to truly find this to be a time of worship. Worship with God. The God who was within us, around us, and before us. Let's join together in prayer. Let us pray. Holy One, you are unity and grace. In you, there are no divisions or separations. Your Spirit blows where it will and fills us with life and hope and compassion. We find ourselves often separated in many ways these challenging days, O God. We're separated with our own struggles that overwhelm and isolate. We ask that you might touch each of us amidst the challenges we face, for only you know us, O God. Where we feel loneliness, touch us with your presence. Where we feel pain, touch us with your healing. Where we feel uncertainty, guide us with your light. We are separated in this time of worship physically. And so we ask that you might unite us in your grace so that we might feel a true sense of gathered communal worship as we gather in word, song and prayer, as we gather here fully with you. Amen. Our scripture reading for today is read by a lady that is normally our singer, but she's going to be reading our scripture today. Betty Noble is reading from the Gospel of Matthew in the 15th chapter. Over to you, Betty.
The reading this morning is from Matthew chapter 15, 10 to 11, and 21 to 28. Then he called the crowd to him and said to them, "Listen and understand. It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but it is what comes out of the mouth that defiles." Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting at us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you have wished." And her daughter was healed instantly. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Could you believe that story you just heard? Can you believe how mad we were when we heard of it? This Canaanite woman from that other land, those dogs that we hate so much, breaking into our land, our territory, and coming to our Jesus asking for healing. I can't tell you how angry we were. We were furious. We had to hold some of the disciples back. I mean, you know, John, the son of thunder, he was ballistic. This lady somehow thought that we would allow Jesus to offer healing for her ill daughter. And somehow she broke through our barricade. She broke through and got in to see Jesus. Well, I was glad when I first heard what I heard. Jesus called her what she is, a dirty dog. We've been calling them. They've got their names for us, and we've got their name. We've got names for them. She called her what she is. Denied her healing. His healing is for the children of Israel. We knew this Jesus is just like us. That's why we worship him. That's why he's our Lord. That's why we love him. That's why we follow him. But then somehow the story got a little more different, didn't it? Jesus changed his mind. Jesus changed his mind. As this woman cried and begged for mercy, Jesus changed his mind. I'm starting to think that maybe I'm going to be changed a little bit as a result of this too. Because this one that we follow is surprising us. He's surprising us in ways that we didn't begin to understand. Those boundaries we had for one another, those separations we had between the other, they don't seem to matter as they once did. Maybe he's teaching us about a love that colors outside the lines. I guess we're going to have to think about that if we're going to follow Jesus. My love colors outside the lines. Let's sing.
My love colored outside the lines, exploring paths that few could ever find, and takes me into places where I've never been before, and opens doors to worlds outside the lines. My Lord colored outside the lines, blessings, water into wine, and takes me into places where I've never been before, and open doors to worlds outside the line. We'll never walk on water if we're not prepared to drown. Body and soul needs a soaking from time to time. And we'll never move the gravestones if we're not prepared to die and realize there are worlds outside the lines. My soul longs to color outside the lines. Tear back the curtain, sun come in and shine. I want to walk beyond the boundaries where I've never been before, through open doors to worlds outside the lines. We'll never walk on water if we're not prepared to drown. Body and soul need a soaking from time to time. And we'll never move the gravestones if we're not prepared to die and realize there are worlds outside the lines.
Friends, would you join with me in prayer? Let us pray. O Holy One, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be ever and always acceptable unto you. For you are our rock and our redeemer, our Alpha and our Omega, our beginning and our end, the source of our love and a wellspring of our joys. Amen. This morning's sermon is all about surprises. Surprise. I wonder how many surprises you might be able to count by the end of our time together. COVID, now that is something that created lots and lots of surprises for each and every one of us, isn't it? Here at the church, it completely changed the way that we offer ministry, and you've adapted in ways you never thought possible, myself included. Online worship, Zoom gatherings virtually through our computers, a telephone tree, mailing out sermons, and so many new ways in which we have had to reinvent being the church. Surprise, Northwood, surprise, world, whether you're ready or not. This is a time to adapt, a time to find new ways to be the church. And indeed, you did. This has been a very surprising and a very challenging time for us, one and all. Challenging indeed. And in some ways separating, they have been hard times as well as challenging. But we still remember church. We remember what it used to be like, don't we? You remember those Sunday gatherings, actual gatherings, not online? Gatherings where the Spirit showed up in surprising ways. Where were you surprised when you gathered? You remember when you'd come right here to church, you would sit right about there and you would sit right about there. I mean, it's a family, so you want to sit together as a family, as a large spiritual community. We would sit in our places and we'd gather. And somehow the Spirit would surprisingly show up. How did the Spirit show up for you in surprise? Perhaps it was that special hymn that somehow provoked wonderful memories of the past. Or perhaps our angelic choir touched your soul in ways that you hadn't imagined. Or perhaps words of children surprised you in our children's time together. Or perhaps you were surprised during moments of silence and prayer when the Spirit stirred and touched you. Or perhaps a surprise of scripture, food for the soul that you took with you for the next steps of your journey ahead. In many ways, you were surprised. Surprised in the ways that the Spirit showed up for you in your life. But we know that, of course, church is not just occurring something on a Sunday morning, as wonderful as it is. Church occurs through the varied events throughout the week and throughout the year. What were the surprises in the ways that the Spirit showed up that you remember? Gatherings of the fall fair or the Advent dinner, Christmas Eve or Easter sunrise, all of the many different things, the Christmas cantata, all those things that are coming to your memory, study groups, fellowship opportunities, outreach ministry, varied ways in which that Spirit showed up, surprised you, enlightened you, and guide you in God's grace. Where did the Spirit surprisingly show up for you, this church? Right now, our board is preparing to convene a meeting next week on Tuesday. We'll be meeting and discussing the topic of returning back to a new normal. Nothing, of course, will ever be the same, but finding some semblance of normalcy and considering what the next steps of the future will bring. We'll meet on Tuesday, and I'll be able to report back at our service next Sunday on the 15th, some more news about plans ahead. It'll surprise you, or maybe it won't surprise you if you've been around the church for a long time, that there is a range of opinions out there, a range of opinions, a range of hopes, a range of desires that we all hold in different ways. Might surprise you that some folks believe that the board have waited far too long and other folks believe the board is moving very, very quickly. It might surprise you about the fears and the concerns and the uncertainties for safety that many people hold. Or it might surprise you to hear about those who are craving opportunities for fellowship and togetherness. How truly much it means for them to see one another's face, to worship together, to tell our faith stories, to sing our faith songs together once again. Surprises, surprises, indeed. Now, this morning's text that we just heard from Betty is not one, at least on the surface, that should be surprising at all. The polarity between groups have been going on for ages and ages, all the way as we see back to biblical times. One group trying to claim superiority over another. In this case, it was the Canaanites and the Hebrew people. They hated each other. Over time, they had developed names for one another, derogatory names. Hatred for one another based on dietary laws, the places they occupied. They were warring peoples. The surprise occurs, though, as we move into the text a little further and we see the actions of the Canaanite woman. Those actions are truly surprising. This Canaanite woman braves the differences between her Canaanite people and the Hebrews like Jesus. She braves their differences and she comes to Jesus because Jesus is known as this universal healer, this one who transcends boundaries, offering God's grace to each and every person, all genders, all people. And she transcends this difference of culture and she comes to him begging for healing. Surprise. Surprise, this Canaanite woman comes with her daughter that needs healing from Jesus. Now, what's not surprising in this text is that Jesus' disciples, once again, don't get it at the beginning. They act more like nightclub bouncers than they do as gracious hosts welcoming people to the party. They first deny this woman, they deny this daughter, not even to get close to Jesus. But somehow she breaks through. She breaks past these big, burly disciples. She breaks through carrying her weak daughter needing healing. And she meets Jesus only to be insulted by Jesus' mouth, being called a dog, and next denying her healing, saying it is only for the children of Israel. Now that is surprising. Did you ever think that you would hear disparaging comments, rude comments coming from the mouth of Jesus? Did you ever think you would hear Jesus denying healing to someone requesting it? I think what's interesting for this is that we meet this very human side of Jesus. We meet this human side of Jesus that quite frankly surprises the heck out of all of us. Because this is not the Jesus we expect to show up. And as we see this side of Jesus, who is rude to the other, who denies the other, we're also comforted in some way, because that represents a part of the human side that we don't always like so much. Jesus in this story at the beginning represents a part of the darkness of our humanity that we keep working on, but still in some ways is there. It's a little more like the human sides of ourselves that we see in Jesus, calling her a dog. We don't give things to the dogs. Hearing Jesus utter rude comments and exclude her. All of a sudden, in some ways, I think what Jesus has done by showing this human side is he has more fully connected himself to his listeners. One theologian commenting on this difficult passage of Jesus said, this is one of the moments when we see Jesus caught with his compassionate pants down. Yes, you heard that odd comment right. Jesus is caught with his compassionate pants down. He doesn't really want to offer much compassion, let alone a call this woman and her daughter very nice things at all, does he? We meet the fully human Jesus who plays favor to some, to his own, who is rude to others. And in our humanity, we become even more fully connected with Jesus because that, frankly, does represent parts of our humanity as well. Yet the surprise, the brilliance, the mastery of this teaching comes towards the end when we see Jesus' mind changed. Weren't you surprised at the end at the twist when Jesus' mind is truly changed, when his actions change? The woman begs for mercy. Please, I beg you, heal my daughter. We can hear the cries and the pains and the concern of this mother. And to those pains and begging, we can hear Jesus change. He responds by healing that little girl. have a theory when we look at this text. I have a theory that Jesus, in fact, planned this surprise from the very beginning. Jesus intended to draw us, each and every one of us, closer to him by showing this full humanity. This full humanity where we are drawn in closer and closer to him in order that we might be transformed by the compassionate surprise that Jesus shows to that little girl and her mother. In one moment, we are drawn into Jesus' humanity. We let our guard down. And in the next moment, the big surprise, Jesus changes. He changes his mind, he confronts those changes and offers healing, offers mercy, and offers grace. We will be forever changed because Jesus has touched our humanity with this teaching. I think the opening in many ways tips us off that Jesus was likely going to do it. Matthew begins the part of this chapter, as Betty read the first few verses, it's not what goes into the mouth that defiles, rather it is what comes out. Jesus is, of course, referring to the different dietary regulations that Canaanite and Jew held, those things that supposedly separated them that were so important, the things that a Jew would put into their mouth and the things that a Canaanite would put into their mouth were vastly different. And Jesus said, it's not what you put into your mouth that will defile, it's what comes out. Before this story even gets off the ground, we know that Jesus is up to a big surprise. Yet as the story ensues, we are hooked. Like the fish drawn in on a fishing hook, we are drawn in for a big, big surprise. Only when we're comfortable, when we've let our guard down and let Jesus fully in, Jesus surprises us with a compassionate surprise, calling us to live with compassionate surprise as well. Jesus shows us how to understand the other. He calls us to do so as well. As I said, this sermon is all about surprises. I don't know how many surprises we've counted. I've lost count through my fingers and toes, but there's quite a lot that we've experienced. This pandemic has showed us way too many surprises. The Spirit showing up in our faith continues to surprise and amaze. And the compassionate call towards other that Jesus teaches us this morning is indeed another surprise that we take with us into our journey. Friends, the next chapter in our ministry, as we consider what it will look like to become the community of faith that will have a new normal moving ahead into this fall, calls us more than ever before to have a deep understanding of the other. This perspective of compassionate surprise is being called from you and from I, for each and every one of us. And in order, friends, in order for us to successfully reunite our communities, we need to found it on understanding, on compassionate understanding of the other, considering one another's fears, considering our hopes, considering our needs, considering our dreams of being the church. May we be surprised by the compassion of others shown, and may we surprise others by the compassion that we show them. For this compassion has first and always surprisingly been shown unto you by God. Amen. And as we consider how we might move ahead in the days and weeks ahead, perhaps this opportunity to take in some music for reflection is a good one now. As we listen to the lyric singers, "You Are the New Day."
You are the new day.
Thank you to the lyric singers for that beautiful piece of music. We follow a God that creates a new day. From death comes new life. From nothing comes creation. Indeed, a God that creates a new day. And indeed, we work in partnership with God for the new days to come ahead. Our offerings are but a symbol of that. As we share portions of our time and our talents and our treasure, we together are able to build little bits of God's kingdom of grace, God's kingdom of compassion that might surprise the world and bring us a little closer together. As we share our offerings, we are blessed by the ways that we can unite them with God's grace and make a difference in the world. Let us pray. Gracious God, we ask that you would receive the offerings we make, these offerings of our lives. As we share portions of our time, of our talents, and of these our treasures, and as we receive gifts to the church, we ask that you would bless them with wise stewardship over their use, that we would continue to be a community embracing others with the love of Christ. This we pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen. And so, friends, as we now gather our prayers together, we give thanks for this way that we might come together and connect spiritually, offering up our prayers and knowing that God guides us and hears all that we offer. Let us all pray. You are a God of surprises, surprising us as your wind blew over creation, surprising us in your arrival in a simple manger, surprising us after a dark Friday, offering new life on a sunrise Easter morning. Your surprises continue as you show up in the most unlikely of places. In the faith of the Canaanite woman, you show up with grace and mercy, blessing us with that same gracious presence. We give thanks for this grace you offer unto us all. O God, we confess the divisions that exist in our world, the divisions that sometimes we perpetuate with our actions and our inactions. Help us to not only receive your gracious welcome, but also to be part of offering it. Help us to be the ones who break down boundaries, welcoming the stranger, creating friendships, and furthering community. We pray for a deeper understanding of one another as we consider moving ahead and finding a new normal in our various ministries in the weeks ahead. Help us to hear the fears and hopes and dreams of the other. Help us to honor them and hold them and create a blessed community in which we can live into the future. Hear the prayer requests that have been offered for us to share in this day. We continue to pray for our world amidst this pandemic. Indeed, we see signs of hope, but yet we also see signs of caution. Oh God, we ask that you would continue to grant us wise practices, care, and compassion. Be with the healers and the scientists in our world. Continue to guide and bless us through this time. We offer the prayers for the World Council of Churches in their ecumenical prayer cycle, who this week invite us to pray for the land and the peoples of Cameroon, the Central African Republic, and Equatorial Guinea. As we move closer to home, we pray for our country that is in many places touched by wildfires. In this scary time, O God, we ask that you would hold us. Hold us. Be with the first responders. Be with the firefighters. And here in our province, O God, we especially need your healing. At a time like this, O God, we just Just pray for rain in the many ways in which you might come and provide. Within our neighborhood, we pray for our friends at the St. George Coptic Orthodox Church following their fire, as they continue to rebuild, as they worship in the field and just look for a new home. God be with them in these challenging days. We pray for the many who walk the path of grief, for the Wolf family, the Wardle family, and the Gaba family. We pray for Kathleen, for Jim, for Linda P., for Laverne B., for Edith, for Lily K., for Ruth S., and for Gail C. These prayers we offer along with those that rest in the silence and sacredness of our hearts, which we offer before you now. Giving thanks that you hear all of our prayers, that you bless them with your grace, and you call us to be blessings and grace to others. We now unite our prayers in that one prayer that Jesus taught us to pray together. And if you're watching this worship in live in the Zoom worship gathering, I invite you to turn your audio on so that we can really pray together, hearing one another's voices in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Friends, go forth into your journey. Go into your day being surprised by compassion, the compassion that God offers unto each and every one of us. And may you in turn also offer ways of compassion and love in your day as well. Go forth knowing that God created us in abundant love, that Christ has defeated even death, offering us all new life, and the wind, the spirit, the breath of God guides us this day and every day into that day. Go forth now in peace. Amen.